God of eternal wisdom, you Lord impart gift of right judgment. Grant us an understanding heart, that we may value wisely the treasure of your kingdom, and gladly forego all blessed gifts. Possess that kingdom's incomparable joy. We make our prayers to our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you.
I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Alleluia, alleluia.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen. Alleluia, alleluia.
Almighty God,
to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Glory to God in the highest,
and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, Holy Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer, for you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Today there will be two callings, the first for the ninth Sunday after Pentecost, and the second for emancipation. O God, the protector of all who trust in you, without whom nothing is strong, nothing is whole, increase and multiply upon us your mercy, that with you as our ruler and guide, we may so pass through things temporal, that we lose not the things eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Liberating God, whose service is perfect freedom, who delivered your people Israel from slavery in Egypt, we thank you for delivering the people of these lands out of enslavement into freedom. And we pray that by your help, we will preserve our freedom, respect, and defend the freedom of others through him by whom we are made free, your Son, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
Please be seated for the ministry of the word.
A reading from the Word of God, written in the first book of Kings, chapter 3, beginning at the 5th verse. At Gibeon, the Lord appeared to Solomon in a dream by night, and God said, "Ask what I should give you." And Solomon said, "You have shown great and steadfast love to your servant, my father David, because he walked before you in faithfulness, in righteousness, and in uprightness of heart toward you. And you have kept for him this great and steadfast love, and have given him a son to sit on his throne to thee. And now, O Lord my God, you have made your servant king in place of my father David. Although I am only a little child, I do not know how to go out or come in. And your servant is in the midst of the people whom you have chosen, a great people, so numerous they cannot be numbered or counted. Give your servant, therefore, an understanding mind to govern your people, able to discern between good and evil, for who can govern this your great people? It pleased the Lord that Solomon had asked this. God said to him, because you have asked this and have not asked for yourself long life or riches or for the life of your enemies, but have asked for yourself understanding to discern what is right, I now do according to your word. Indeed, I give you a wise and discerning mind. No one like you has been before you, and no one like you shall arise after you. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm appointed for today is Psalm 119. We shall read our turn in verses 129 to 136, pausing at the asterisk in each verse. Your decrees are wonderful. Therefore, I obey them with all my heart.
When your word goes forth, it is my eyes. It gives understanding to the simple.
I open my mouth and pass them. I long for your commandments.
Turn to me in mercy, as I so always do to those who love your name.
Steady my footsteps in your word. Let no iniquity have dominion over me.
Rescue me from those who oppress me. And I will keep your commandments.
Let your countenance shine upon your servant. And teach me your statutes.
My eyes shall see dreams of tears. Because people do not keep your law.
Glory to the Father, and the Son, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit,
as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen.
Reading from the Word of God, written in the letter to the Romans, chapter 8, beginning at the 26th verse. The Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we ought. But that very Spirit intercedes with sighs too deep for words. And God, who searches the heart, knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. We know that all things work together for good for those who love the Lord, who love God, who are called according to his purpose. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that he might be the firstborn within a large family. those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified. What then are we to say about these things? If God is for us, who is against us? He who did not withhold his own son, but gave him up for all of us, will he not with him also give us everything else? Who will bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? It is Christ Jesus who died, yes, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all day long. We are accounted as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus, our Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to Christ our Savior.
Jesus put before them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed that someone took and sowed in his field. It is the smallest of all the seeds. But when it has grown, it is the greatest of shrubs and becomes a tree, so that the birds of the air come and make nests in its branches. He told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like yeast that a woman took and mixed in with 3 measures of flour until all of it was leavened. The king of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field that someone found and hid. Then in his joy he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls. On finding one pearl of great value, he went and sold all that he had and bought it. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was thrown into the sea and caught fish of every kind. When it was full, they drew it ashore, sat down, and put the good into baskets, but threw out the bad. So it will be at the end of the age. The angels will come out and separate the evil from the righteous and throw them into the furnace of fire, where they will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Have you understood all this? They answered, yes. And he said to them, therefore, every scribe who has been trained for the kingdom of heaven is like the master of a household who brings out of his treasure what is new and what is old. The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to Christ, our Lord.
Overpowering circumstances, imprisoned in a depressing cloud of anxiety, feeling forsaken. Hear the good news, brothers and sisters. Absolutely nothing can get between God's love and us. Absolutely nothing can get between God's love and us. I am smiling and you're probably wondering why. But when God lays something on your heart and you are obedient, but still you aren't sure that this word is meant to be shared, God finds a way to show you. And this morning, as I got out of the car, the heel came off my shoe. And I walked slowly, but that one was still scraping. And so I said, Lord, nothing can get in the way of delivering your word. Not my doubt and not my burden. So sitting there, I took the shoes off. So let us listen to Paul's word of awe-inspiring reassurance in his letter to the church in Rome, and by extension, believers everywhere, as he unequivocally states, and I use the Message paraphrase of a few verses, do you think anyone is going to be able to drive a wedge between us and Christ's love for us? There is no way. Not trouble, not hard times, not hatred, not hunger, not homelessness, not bullying threats, not backstabbing, not even the worst sins listed in Scripture. They kill us in cold blood because they hate you. We are sitting ducks. They pick us off one by one. None of this fazes us because Jesus loves us. I am absolutely convinced that nothing living or dead, angelic or demonic, today or tomorrow, high or low, thinkable or unthinkable, absolutely nothing can get between us and God's love because of the way that Jesus, our Master, has embraced us. End of the verses. Brothers and sisters, we have the assurance. We have the reassurance. No matter what burden may have accompanied us here, no matter what may attempt or is threatening our peace of mind, no matter what is causing discomfiture, nothing, no one can stop God's presence with us. Beloved, God, whose love for us is unconquerable, will never abandon us. For those who were present last week, you would have heard a story about a young student who was in grief. And those to whom she looked to for comfort gave her words. But the words did not touch her in her grief. And as she was passing a homeless man, a man whom she was accustomed to seeing on her journey home, a man who saw her, came from his comfort zone, or from his bed of discomfort, and hugged her. And it made the difference. Like that young student, who in the midst of her grief was gripped by utter loneliness, the tender touch of the ever-loving God of all comforts calmed her aching soul. And she knew that God, who sees, understands, and is a very present help. This God, our God, desires to do the same for you, for me, for all. Like the homeless human being, often invisible or spurned by those in his society, the transformational touch of the all-seeing, all-knowing God of love enabled this obedient, teachable child to look beyond the self, to rise from a bed of discomfort and become God's channel of loving comfort to one in need. This God, our God, desires to do the same for you, for me, for all. What an all-wise, all-powerful God of limitless love, who companions, guides, gives us with what he knows we need as he transforms us on this journey called life. At this stage of my life, I am thankful to God for his deep, deep abiding love that enables all those who trust and will trust him to wonderfully emerge from our gloomy, ill-fitting cocoons of disquiet, insecurity, and pain. As I share that, I remember a gift of a dress, some of you may have heard about it before, that a well-intentioned friend living overseas sent to me. I was 23 years and 69. And at that time, I was teaching 3 to 4 year old infants. Seems like eons ago. Yet, it is one of those aha moments. It was a weightless floral fabric, elastic in the neck, in the waist, and in the puff sleeves. A sash of the same fabric complimented the outfit. It was the style of that era. When I put it on, I somehow knew it was not for me. Yet, the assurance of my then 2-year-old and my spouse that it was okay, and the love of the giver encouraged my keeping it on and bearing it to school. I must admit, I felt a bit uncomfortable and queried my decision. While sitting in the housekeeping area, a rather adorable little student with a most engaging smile came up to me. She sat comfortably in my lap. Still smiling, she looked into my eyes. Mrs. scream, she said, while fingering my dress. I know this is not a nightie. But it looks like a night. Really, I could not help but laughing inwardly as I heard myself softly saying her name, followed by thank you. You know, I said, Mrs. Graham was not so sure she should wear this dress, but two people told her it looked okay. Thank you. Mrs. Graham is not going to wear this dress to school anymore. She hugged me and returned to her chosen activity. Never again did I wear that outfit in public. My little messenger from God had taken the time from her busy routine to intimately sit with me. She knew me, and in her childlike wisdom, she looked beyond my attempt to appear as if all were well. She not only saw, but identified the reality of my dis-ease. Leaving her comfort zone, this little child in whom God resided risked making herself vulnerable by graciously entering my space of not knowing to say, I care about you, and I want to see you looking, feeling, and being your best on this journey called life. Doesn't God say the same to us? Maybe it is not your literal clothing this morning. Whatever the garment, you know how ill-fitting it is. You know the depth of the anxiety, the anger, the heartache, the heaviness, or maybe the detachment, the deadness you are experiencing. You know that this ill-fitting garment does not serve the journey of growing in grace that God through Jesus Christ invites us to. How do you deal with it? How do I deal with it? Today, as painful as our situation might be, just like my trying to scrape up there with the shoes, we are being given the opportunity to give ourselves over to the one who knows us, the one who loves us as we are. Yet, here comes the punchline, the one who loves us too much to let us stay dressed as we are. I invite us to find a neighbor and to say to him or her, God in Christ loves you too much to let you stay dressed as you are. Let us practice it. God in Christ
loves you too much to let you stay dressed.
Now find someone to say that. You know, the man has to move from his comfort zone, and some of you are being called to move from your comfort zone. brothers and sisters in Christ. God in Jesus Christ loves us too much to let us stay as we are. And so I remind us that he is nearer to us than our breath. This love, Jesus the Christ, has the power to heal any brokenness the ill-fitting garment may have caused, has caused, or is causing. And so I invite us to pause for a quiet, God-gifted moment of grace. You may close your eyes if you desire. Take several deep breaths as a way of settling into the quiet intimacy that God desires you both to share. Allow yourself to feel the safety of this time, this space, God's presence. Relax in the comfort of the divine presence. Take a few moments to enjoy the divine presence as you snuggle close. Allow the Holy Spirit to guide your attention to the supreme face that is divine love. See the love light in his eyes for you. Feel the strange warmth of the divine love for you. Feel the strange warmth as it touches every fiber of your being. Hear the soothing voice of reassurance as divine love says, I love you too much to let you stay dressed as you are.
is happening. Whatever you may be experiencing, simply stay with it. Don't try to run from it. God in Christ, all that you are experiencing. God in Christ, if there is anything He desires you to do in response. Invite God in Christ, who loves you dearly, to give you with exactly what you need. Then you are ready to receive God's wonder-filled gift. Close this time with a prayer of gratitude to God for His presence with you. This special time of togetherness comes to a close. May you hear the reassurance in the words of St. Paul. Nothing or no get in the way of God's love for you. Absolutely nothing. God, any mountain.
Invite us to rise in the power and love of Almighty God as we reaffirm our faith in Him using the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen or unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, one in being with the Father, through whom all things were made. For us and for our salvation, He came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, He was born of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, He was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and died and was buried. On the third day, He rose again in fulfillment of the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and His kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father. With the Father and the Son, He is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Thank you.
Let us pray to God, by whose grace we are members of the kingdom of heaven. Call to your service, may we and the whole church be faithful in all things. Grant that we shall be good stewards of the great church entrusted to us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Reveal the true treasure of your world, of your word, to those whose eyes are closed by the cares of this world. Plant the seed that shall grow up into a better life for all. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Make us conquerors through Christ of all that would harm our living together with others. May our whole community grow towards your kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give to those who suffer the assurance that they are not forgotten, never separated from the love of Christ. May his sufferings for humanity relieve their troubles. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
When the time of judgment is fulfilled, look with mercy on the souls of the departed. By the merits of Christ, let them not be lost in that day. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Trusting in the mercy of God, the judge of all, we submit our prayers in the name of Christ. Amen.
Amen.
We continue in prayer. As we remember those known to us and those not known who are sick, who are dying, who are troubling in spirit, who are experiencing dis-ease and disease of any kind. We ask God in His love and mercy
Jamaica. Sister Jean Murray, the mother of our brother Andrew Murray. John and Andrew, the brothers of Sister Salvina Moore. In the midst of the disease, may they feel your touch of love, that touch that goes to the soul, that touch that says you are mine, and not even this condition separate you from my love. Have your way, dear God. We remember our youngsters who are preparing to go off for further education. We also bring to you, dear God, their parents, who in their unknowing have anxieties. Those for whom the pain of separation digs deep, that they mask it. Help them, dear God, to remember that you have the ultimate control of their children as you do them. And it is your desire that they should embrace life in all its fullness and live it fully. You know each of them by name and nature, dear God. And even as you see them this morning, let them feel that smile that says, I will never leave you or forsake you. I will be with you always. Guard them, we pray. We know you go before them to prepare the way, even as you companion them on the way. Who is like you, dear God? There is none like you. Oh God, you know each of us. And you know your desire for us. So continue to shine your light in the midst of our doubts, in the midst of our apprehensions to risk. May your light touch every place, even those places that we try to hide from you. And may your light comfort us with the assurance that not only will you supply our need, but the fact, the truth, that no matter what may come our way, all things will work together for good for all who love you and assert our trust in you. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
So be spirit can be still and know that you are God. Spare to us our pains. Soften to us our enemies. Bless us, if it may be, in all our innocent endeavors. If it may not, give us the strength to encounter that which is to come, that we may be brave in peril, constant in tribulation, temperate in wrath, and in all the changes of fortune, down to the pits of death, loyal and loving to you and to one another. If we are celebrating birthdays or anniversaries of any kind, be free to accept God's invitation to come for a blessing. Continue with the act. We are the body of Christ. By the one Spirit, we were all baptized into one body, and have all been made to drink of the one Spirit.
Let us then pursue the things that make for peace and build up a common life.
My brothers and sisters, the peace of the Lord be always with you.
Thank you.
on the night he was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, take this and eat it. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it, for the remembrance of me. The gifts of God. May the Spirit of truth lead you into all truth, giving you grace to confess that Jesus Christ is Lord and to proclaim the wonderful works of God. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always.
Amen.
Just remains for me to wish you a wonderful day.
day. And remember that God in Christ loves us too much to let us stay.